Okay, everybody awake? Ready to go? Okay, I see Nathan nodding. Okay, not nodding off, but nodding. That's a good sign. Jason, Christian, Shauna, Hayden, everybody ready? Okay, there's a smiley face. A sleepy face. All right, let's get into this. This is a marketing class, but we're going to talk about something that you guys never would probably expect. We're going to talk about something that I call the four acronyms of the apocalypse. And the reason, and here they are, AI, everybody know what that is? AR, VR, and IoT. Now, the reason that we're going to talk about those is because those four acronyms are going to affect your life more than social media has, more than any other technology on earth. It's already here at certain levels. More AI is around us everywhere. We're going to talk about that. And as marketers, it's going to be your job to completely understand this. If you understand these four acronyms that we're going to talk about, then you're going to have an edge over everybody else because it's coming. Whether we like it or not, it's coming and we need to understand it. So that's why I'm going to put you guys on the cutting edge of information here. Now, before we begin, have any questions, type it into the chat bar or wave your hand. The problem is once I get going, I get excited and I don't often check the chat bar. So don't worry about it. Just hold those questions to the end and or wave your arm frantically, whatever. The webinar is going to be recorded. So if you want to see all this wonderful information and get it again, it's going to be on demand for Dr. Witt. While we're doing this, you know, stay active. Will you kind of stay engaged because you're going to get a lot more out of it. And so am I. So don't check your emails and Facebook and Instagram and TikTok and all that other stuff. I understand how important it is, but just put your phone down for now. No playing with your dog, cat, parakeet, ferret, or goldfish. My dog is right over here asleep and I really want to pet it, but I'm here with you guys. So don't do that. No dozing off, making breakfast, or posting still images of your face so that I think you're there, but you're actually asleep. So don't do that. And everybody here has to ask at least one good question or you're buying lunch. Just that simple. We're going to keep track of that. All right. My biography. You guys probably already seen it. Yeah, it's insane. Really, a whole bunch of really weird stuff. So I'm not going to spend any time on that. Okay, here it is. The big four. Now, first of all, does everybody know what those four are? Do they understand at least what the terminology means? Okay, that's what I thought. I see two people that did paste still images of their face because I don't see their eyes blinking. Okay, there we go. These are really important. You got to trust me. You're going to come back a few years from now and say, oh my God, that crazy guy was right. AI, do you have any idea who this is? Chat bar, say it out loud. What is that image? Nobody know?
A camera?
Yep. But more than that, this was the first time that people were really introduced to AI. And I think it was around 1964, 65, late 60s. This is HAL. Anybody remember the HAL 9000? Has anybody seen 2001 Space Odyssey by Arthur C. Clarke? Okay, that's kind of a homework assignment. It's worth watching. First of all, Stanley Kubrick is one of the greatest directors that have ever lived. Arthur C. Clarke was a futurist and wrote some absolutely amazing books. And featured in there was this is in the 60s. I mean, it's hard to even comprehend this, but they were on a space mission to Jupiter. And this was the AI computer that ran the entire spaceship. And it was called the HAL 9000. And of course it went amok and killed all the, I'm not gonna tell you the plot, but it was our first experience of what AI is, artificial intelligence. But look it up, 2001 Space Odyssey was pretty cool. I've been involved in all of these categories since way before you guys were born. I actually worked with artificial intelligence when I worked on the Hanford Nuclear Reservation, developing the world's first artificial intelligent computer system for tracking weapons-grade uranium and plutonium. Not something I was really proud of, other than we developed a system that actually worked and was one of the first in the world. Augmented reality. It's, again, something that I worked with all the way back in the 70s, and it's taken this long for it to mature and actually come into our lives. Virtual reality. I've been heavily involved in virtual reality since the 80s. I strongly recommend it. It's like gaming. It's like first-person shooter and some of the other online games, fully immersive environments. So if you're not familiar with VR, it's a heck of a lot of fun, and it's also educational. And then IoT, Internet of Things. Again, I was doing that from the mid-80s on, actually having devices talk to one another, electronic devices. Now, I want to, that actually is my little dog that's on the floor right now, but this is, I want to introduce you to the face of artificial intelligence. A moment ago, I showed you Hal, that was a face of artificial intelligence, and it could be really any face. It could be in the form of a chatbot, it could be artificial character like an avatar. It could be a photograph. It could be an interaction with voice. Siri is artificial intelligence. Siri doesn't have a face, but it has a logo that you all recognize. Artificial intelligence. If we can connect artificial intelligence to something that we already feel comfortable with, we'll accept it faster. So when I use artificial intelligence, and I do on all of my websites, I have chatbots. Chatbot is a form of artificial intelligence. I use images that people can relate to so that they can warm up to it faster. But you're going to see more and more artificial intelligence.
Hi, my name is Bella. How can I help you?
And that's how it actually works on my website. There's somebody there, this little dog talks. I sell school projects on one of my websites, primarily to elementary schools and middle schools. And the dog really works out well. Every kid can relate to a dog. So let's get actually into the weeds here and define what all of these are. Let's start with the one at the end, Internet of Things. Definition is Internet of Things is the interconnection of computing devices embedded in everyday objects via the internet. But really, what does that mean? It means that from this point on, almost every single device that we get, and I say device, so you're thinking probably smartphone or AirBook or laptop. No, I'm talking about toaster oven, refrigerators, doorbells, cars, anything that's electronic at one point or another either has or will have some kind of a chip in it that's going to run software that's going to make that device operate to its fullest. Think about that. Home thermostats. Everything has got a chip in it nowadays. And if you can put a chip in, you can put a software, you can put Wi-Fi, which means that a toaster oven actually can talk to your cell phone, or your cell phone could check your refrigerator to see what you need at the store when you're shopping, to see what's not in the refrigerator. But they can also talk between themselves. And that's where it kind of gets a little scary. I don't know that I want my toaster oven talking to my refrigerator behind my back. I don't think my refrigerator likes me already. So that could be a problem. But it's what it means is everything electronic basically being completely interconnected. Now, you see the picture of the doorbell there. Now, we're all very familiar with what a doorbell looks like. And that costs about $2 at a hardware store or a big box store. But if you would have told me 5 years ago, I'm going to sell you that same thing, a doorbell, but it's going to cost you $200, I'd have laughed at you because I can get one for $2. But somebody did that and it actually worked. You're probably familiar with Ring. Ring is an amazing form of artificial intelligence. What it means is that when you go up, you don't even have to touch the doorbell. It has a motion sensor, artificial intelligence. It knows when somebody is near the doorbell, so it activates itself, just like if I say the word, I'll do it, Alexa, stop. If you say that word, they know that you're talking. Well, the doorbell knows, but the coolest thing is that it can actually connect with you through your cell phone anywhere in the world and send you a video and audio. So artificial intelligence actually is embedded in everything, as simple as even a doorbell or a thermostat. This is the old-fashioned thermostat. You can buy them probably for about $10. But now, what do we have? We have Nest. Nest allows your cell phone to connect with your thermostat. which means that it could tell you what the temperature is. You can change the temperature. You can set it for predetermined times. And it has enough artificial intelligence built into it that it can actually, through a motion sensor, test when you're in and out of your house, keep track of those times, and turn itself on and turn itself off and anticipate when you're going to need heat or air conditioning. Think about that, a thermostat that's smart enough to know when you're home or when you're going to be home so that it can control all those devices in your house. Now, in the old days when we had a car, there was no computers in them, and it made it a lot easier to, not to diagnose, but to repair. But now, all cars have software, they have chips. So you can have full diagnostics. It could tell you every single thing, right down to whether or not a light bulb is working or the pressure, air pressure in your tires. And if there's anything that needs upgrading in your computer software, it will automatically connect to the internet, connect to a satellite, and download and upgrade your car. I mean, think about that. Your car actually fixes itself while you're not looking. Kind of cool. Internet of Things. All of this took place, all of this happened because of this. Well, actually not that, that's an old-fashioned telephone, but really when we did this, when we moved and disconnected the wires from our phones and went to smartphones, because that smartphone has about 100 times more computing power than the rocket that actually landed men on the moon. I mean, think about that. There's more than 100 times the computational power in that than the entire spaceship that landed the men on the moon. Well, with Wi-Fi and all of the other capabilities that this device has, now this is the central clearing spot for all of our other devices to interact with us. And a lot of companies, as I said, are already camping onto this. You can remotely, using your smartphone, lock and unlock your car. So let's say a friend, a wife, a spouse is using your car and they lost the fob, can't get in, not a problem. They call you and you just unlock it remotely from anywhere on earth. I mean, think about that. Isn't that amazing that you can unlock the car, but you can also locate it if you can't find it. You lost it in a parking lot or someone stole it. Just use your smartphone. It could check tire pressure, oil pressure, odometer. And you can even set it up so that in the morning, your car will say, hey, dude, you got to drive to work this morning. Traffic on the 60 is a little bit heavy. So what do you say you take an alternate route? And oh, by the way, you're probably going to need gas, but you won't need it today. You can probably wait until the weekend. That's not unheard of. That actually is happening. Chevrolet has built that into a lot of the newer models, that every morning your car will give you a full status report on how it's working. Think about the amazing capabilities that we're talking about. But you as a marketer, you need to understand, how are you going to sell this? How did Chevrolet in particular build those feature benefits into their products so that they now understand how to communicate all of these capabilities to their customers, especially capabilities and benefits that their customers have no idea exist or even how to use? How do you tell someone that here is a benefit that you can't live without when you've lived your entire life without it? Huh, how about that for a marketing question? And I just wanted to pop up, here's some of the companies that are actually working actively on artificial intelligence and building all of that stuff into our daily lives, basically. And it's not a flash in the pan, it's not a fad. Companies are spending literally hundreds of billions of dollars trying to figure out how to get our devices smarter. Now, this was a Super Bowl ad that played last January during the Super Bowl. Remember that, when we used to have football games that people could go to and sit around and have a beer and watch? Yeah, they were the good old days. Never thought that last January would be the good old days. But this is a commercial that, it was very odd also that Budweiser teamed up with Uber. You don't see that very often, where two companies. Now, in marketing, one of the things that I teach is when companies complement one another but don't compete. And remember, Budweiser and Uber complement one another, but they don't compete with each other. You can team up, and you're seeing more and more of this, because you're getting, your budget can be half, but you're getting more than double the exposure. Let me play this commercial because I think it's a great example of how artificial intelligence is infiltrating our world and how us as a society now are being introduced to it.
Hey, what's up?
Not much. Wishing I was watching the game, having a bud. What's up with you?
Like you, wishing I was watching the game, having a bud.
True. True.
What's up?
What's up?
What's up?
What's up?
Yo, where's D-Unit?
What's up?
What's up?
It's a smart world. Don't be stupid about how you get around tonight. Use Uber promo code WhatsUp to help get home after the game. Must be legal drinking age.
That was close.
True. True.
So, what did you think of that? Could you hear it? Could you see it? Everything okay with that? With that video? Give me a nod. Give me a thumbs up. Okay, cool. Isn't that amazing? I mean, look, any one of those devices we're all comfortable with. And what happens when they all start talking to one another? I mean, even the Roomba is moving around the floor. I mean, I think that's amazing. So what we're doing is being conditioned to understand that this artificial intelligence and intercommunication and this Internet of Things is actually happening. And so we could all relate to that commercial. But again, 10 years ago, that commercial wouldn't have made any sense. Imagine where you as a marketer and this technology is going to be 10 years from now. And that's when you're going to be in the marketplace earning your maximum amount of income. And you need to understand this. Okay, let's talk a little bit more about AI. The definition, AI, artificial intelligence, it is when intelligence is demonstrated by machines through code, in contrast to the natural intelligence displayed by humans. So really what we're doing is we're just programming computers. And I was a computer programmer. I programmed over 1.2 million lines of code, and I developed some of the first AI. There's nothing magical. There's nothing scary. There's no Skynet. We don't have to worry about the end of the world, the Terminator's coming. AI is really, we just teach computers to mimic, to pretend, to act like the way we would make decisions. For example, if somebody came up to our door, we would see somebody coming up to our door. So we program that intelligence into the doorbell. It's not really intelligence, it's just mimicking things that we call human intelligence. Not a big deal. Now, Elon Musk is terrified of AI, and so is Stephen Hawking. And these are two really brilliant men. So maybe there is something we at least need to be cautious of. Now, here's a couple of examples. I don't know if you're familiar with Sophia, but Sophia is a robot, but really brilliant, great robot. And I forgot what country it was, but one country actually gave her citizenship, which made it the first robot ever to become a citizen of a country. I mean, it was a publicity stunt, of course, but it was pretty cool that they would think of it. Automobiles, AI is built into it. You don't even see it. It controls your gas air mixture. It pretty much everything in the car. It controls and it watches. It keeps an eye on. Of course, Pandora. Something Pandora, Netflix, Amazon. Anytime you go into any one of those websites or use their services, you're knee deep in artificial intelligence. For example, you go to Amazon, other customers who have bought the product you're looking at bought these. Yeah, that's not true. No, there's artificial intelligence built into it that actually looks at your previous purchases and tries to calculate what you would like to buy next. Not true. Netflix, they're still working on their AI because if you've ever seen, oh, you liked this movie, so we're gonna give you this movie. Yeah, not so much. You watched Frozen, so you're going to love Texas Chainsaw Massacre. Yeah, not so much. So it's getting better. And then, of course, over on the right-hand side, you recognize those two. One's in your phone and the other one's on your desk, which I can't live without that Amazon one. And I don't want to say her name again because she's going to wake up and start talking. But hey, that's AI, and it's all around us. The most common form of AI is chatbots. I just recently wrote a book called Artificial Intelligence, Chatbots, Unexpected Positive Consequences. And it hit number one on Amazon. The reason I'm telling you this is I don't care if you go and buy the book. I only make 99 cents on it. Actually, I make 38 cents on it. Big deal. But it hit number one. It stayed there for 3 weeks and it was in three categories. People are wanting to understand about chatbots because it's a form of artificial intelligence that's going to affect customer service more than anything. And remember, customer service is the most important part of marketing. Customer service is the most important part of marketing because a happy customer will tell a lot of people, and it's easy to make a customer happy. And chatbots do that by giving them answers, finding products, getting answers to technical questions, service questions, mostly finding products. I saw when I implemented the chatbot on one of my e-commerce websites, first 30 days, I saw a 35% increase in revenue just because I had a chatbot there. And what I found was is people had questions that I never anticipated. If I buy it today, how long before I get it? Where can I find this product? Do you have this product? Do you have a coupon? Discount code. I never anticipated a lot of those questions. And because the customers got their questions answered immediately, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, by a chatbot that doesn't cost me anything to keep on the website, I saw a 35% increase in revenue. So as a marketing person, you want to know how whatever company you're working for, how you can take the responsibility to increase revenue, because it's your responsibility to understand how your customers are thinking, what's important to them. So chatbots are very important. And matter of fact, if you want a copy of the book, I'm happy to send it to you. Just contact me and I'll give it to you for free. It's that important. Now here's another example of AI that I wanted to show you. This is, again, it was a Super Bowl ad and I think it's really funny, but it also shows how smart automobiles are becoming, the artificial intelligence that's built into them. It's called SmartPak.
Oh, look at this guy. Hey, Rachel, how are you?
Hey, good. How are you?
He's not getting that car in there.
No, sir.
Look at these two troublemakers.
Hey, Johnny, how are you?
Wicked car. Is that new?
Yeah, it's a Sonata. Let me pack it.
Oh, you're not fitting your car in there.
Chris, stop being a smarty pants, all right? Look who's got SmartPak.
SmartPak?
Just hit the clicker, car packs itself.
It's smart.
It's wicked smart. And I can pack it anywhere.
How about Dorchester?
Packed it.
Foxborough?
Packed it.
The Garden?
Packed it.
Saugus?
Packed it.
Swampscott?
Revere?
The Harbor?
Are you kidding me? I packed it and then unpacked it.
You unpacked it?
Kid.
Game changer.
That Sonata ain't got no driver.
That's all right. He's got SmartPak.
Hey, you can pack there.
He's got SmartPak!
Hey, whoa, it's Big Poppy.
Wicked smart.
This is a ghost car.
A better way to park. Only available on the all-new Sonata with remote smart parking assist.
Sorry about that, your bigness. Did you guys know he lived there?
I had no idea.
Wicked smart. That's where we're headed. And a matter of fact, the United States just approved, I think it's called the Level 3 self-driving car, which means that Honda, I think, is going to be the first one to do it. But all you do is go to your GPS, tell you the car where you want it to go, and you just kick back. Talk about autopilot. It will actually drive your car to that location. Now, the steering wheel and the brakes and everything are still going to be in there. That has something to do with that Level 3. We're not going to remove that yet. But we're almost at that point. That's how smart that device, that mechanical device, has become. Yeah, pretty weird. Now, I know this is a little dark, and I apologize, especially first thing in the morning. But here's something I just found that I think is amazing. Missing persons. We are to the point where we can take DNA from a decomposed body, which we can't identify. We put it in a computer. It'll analyze the DNA and actually come back with a photograph based on that person's DNA. And here's two examples of missing persons. They're not perfect, but can you imagine generating a photograph from DNA? That's artificial intelligence at a whole nother level. I was shocked when I saw that. But let's move on to something a little bit lighter and fluffier. AR, augmented reality. Augmented reality means you're going to start with reality, and we're going to use our smartphone camera to do that, and we're going to augment that reality with information of some sort. Now, if you look at the image, you can see, you can hold your camera up, let's say Mill Avenue, downtown Tempe, or any, New Orleans, the French Quarter. You hold your camera up and you look, and the reality in your camera as you're moving it around will have this information overlaid over it. Wow, could you imagine looking through the lens of a camera and having all this information at your fingertips, just automatically put into the image? Now, let me give you some examples of that. Again, top left, you can see all the different shops, restaurants. You can even get ratings on the restaurants. Over on the right-hand side, you can play games just by it. Basically, it connects an image to a program. So you take a picture of a dollar bill, you put your camera up, and you're actually playing a game. Same thing on the lower left. And the lower right is a high school teacher who is smart enough to be able to program augmented reality so that as the students are walking around looking with their cameras, they can actually see the solar system moving around live through their cameras as if it was actually in the room. Now, Lowe's is on the cutting edge. Lowe's has done a great job. Cabinets just by flicking your finger and wearing those goggles. Wow, think about that. Now, again, from a marketing perspective, this is going to be your job to interface with your customers. If you were working for Lowe's, how are you going to take the technology that they developed and turn that into a usable marketing campaign? Here's another example. Look at that, hedge trimmers. A lot of women are uncomfortable about buying and using them because they don't think that they can handle them. So use them. And look at this. You buy a piece of furniture and it shows, have you ever been in a big box store where you can't find something? Just plug it in and it will show you on the floor how to find it. I mean, amazing technologies. Look at this one. A lot of companies are using that so that you can actually see what the furniture will look like in your house, in your apartment, in your dorm before you actually buy it. And you can put it in the room, you can move it around, you can turn it around. And here's another example of a bathroom sink and cabinet. Again, right on your smartphone, just moving your finger around. This is a video that I did, just moving my finger around. But you can imagine being able to do that with furniture. It's gonna be your job as a marketer to show people why that's important. Here's one more I want to give you because I just found this a couple of days ago and I wanted to put it in here. Take a peek at this one.
Ooh.
Oh.
Thank you.
Uh-oh. Attention.
Hoppa!
Get it!
Yay!
Oh! Oh no!
Oh, I got her. She had to.
I mean, it's not something that you have to sell the idea or market or promote, but I'll tell you, could you imagine the word of mouth? I would go to that restaurant just to experience that. And dining isn't necessarily, it's not necessarily an experience, but that adds a whole nother level. And how simple, they just had the cartoon created. They have a couple of projectors that are mounted up above the table. Extremely creative. And remember, the most important thing that you can do as a marketer is be creative. That's what's going to set you aside from everything else, everybody else. It's your creativity. Your creativity is the only thing that's going to set you aside from everybody else. Everyone else has the same tools. They all have access to video, have access to text, to images. We all have that. But you see here, someone really stepped out of those nine dots, got into the weeds, and came up with this concept. That's, I think, amazing. Let me show you another video here. Augmented reality again. Traditional category. That's exactly right. If you go to work for a company that's been around for a while, it's going to be a traditional product and more than likely a traditional category. So how do you do something different, something like this, that allow your product to stand out above the competition? Now we're back to that creativity again. Being creative is what's going to set you aside from everybody else. That's kind of cool because you're interacting and experiencing a bottle of wine. And you can be doing this in the store. It doesn't have to be at home on your kitchen table, but you can interact and actually become immersed in the story of that brand just by pointing your smartphone camera at it. Okay, VR. You guys doing all right? Everybody okay? Yeah? You okay? All right, good. VR. Definition of VR. First of all, VR is virtual reality. It's been around for a while. I came up with some of the first virtual reality, developed a virtual reality operating system back in the mid-80s, and it's been growing ever since then. For more than a decade, actually I think it's 17, almost 18 years, Second Life was the biggest virtual reality platform anywhere on Earth. I participated in Second Life for more than a decade. And we'll talk about that here in a second. And virtual reality just means that all of the reality that you're viewing through goggles, through a screen, through a smartphone screen, is created by a computer. It's not augmenting actual reality, it's recreating it. and it's an immersive three-dimensional reality. As I said earlier, it's similar to a first-person shooter game or some of the other video games that we play today. Now, there's dozens and dozens of them out there now. Virbella is a really good business platform, school platform. It's called Virbella. Go take a look at that. That's a homework assignment. It's pretty good. Here's some images of me flying around my property. That's my mansion behind. First floor, you can see it on the lower pictures. You can see that I had a store. I sold books and CDs and DVDs, and I actually did business. Now, think about this for a second. I had a virtual store selling virtual products because the virtual products were all downloadable. The DVDs, the books, everything was 100% downloadable, either as an MOV or a PDF or whatever, JPEGs. So I have a virtual store in a virtual world selling virtual products. And people would come into this place, buy my products. And the only way I knew that somebody had entered my store and bought a product is because I got real money. I got an email that said X amount of dollars have been deposited into your account. You got to think of that concept. This is 10 years, 12 years ago. This is all, actually it was all the way back in 2007 when I did this concept. 100% virtual. The only thing that was real was the deposits in my bank account. Kind of cool, isn't it? And it was a lot of fun. I taught classes. I did executive interviews. This class I could have taught in virtual reality, which I had for social media. Interviewed the CEO of Second Life in Second Life. And what I didn't realize is that while I was doing this interview, there was somebody from CNN actually sitting in the audience virtually. His avatar was there. And it turned out that I did the first virtual reality interview of a CEO in history. And within 30 minutes, I was on CNN headline news. And if it's still out there, if you type in my name, Lon Safko, and CNN and Second Life, you'll see the story. It's still out there after more than a decade. They never took it down. So it was the first executive interview ever to take place in a virtual world. And that's me. And that was Mark Kingdon. That's his real picture. And that was him on the right. No, that was him on the left. And I was on the right. Kind of cool, right? And also participated in an event. I kind of hosted part of it for the American Cancer Society. We raised $3.5 million for cancer research in a virtual world. Honestly, we had a virtual run. Our avatars actually ran and we gave away gifts and prizes. We had so many people attend this event that we actually crashed all of the Linden Lab servers. It couldn't handle the traffic. Linden Lab is the company that owned Second Life. We crashed the servers because we had such a high attendance. In a virtual world. Now, here's a bunch of companies that are out there that are providing virtual reality platforms. Again, even Dr. Witt. Dr. Witt was my guest speaker at two classes that I taught internationally. I had people from Zurich, Italy, Australia, far away as Texas. And I taught these classes several times, and Dr. Witt was my guest speaker at the graduation. And if you want to see that, you want to see these classes graduating from Second Life. And these were real classes. These were $1,500 a class. They got a certificate and a diploma. Again, type in Lon Safko Second Life graduation and you'll see that. And you'll even hear Dr. Witt's speech. It was pretty cool. First time that he ever did a commencement address at in a virtual world. Now, I'm not kidding about virtual reality not only being a reality, but becoming more of a reality. Amazon is dumping hundreds of millions of dollars into something called Sumerian, and it's for business. The idea is for businesses to go in and create these avatars, to do it easily, to have high quality, lifelike the avatars, and then actually create environments where a business, and you'll see it on the lower left, a teacher can go in and teach a class. You can walk in, talk to your other students, take a seat, watch a PowerPoint presentation. Amazon is serious about this, and I agree, because in the lower left, coming in, hearing me speak, watching a PowerPoint presentation was all something that I was doing 10 years ago for people from around the world. Now, other companies are really taking it serious. This is one that you need to keep an eye on because the quality is there, and Amazon has got the money and the resources to develop something that's going to be really good. Now, the goggles is really what takes it to a second level. You can do all of these virtual reality platforms just using your smartphone or a standard computer screen, but it's the goggles that really set it aside. And what the goggles do is it creates that three-dimensional look. So as you move your head around, everything actually looks three-dimensional, close and far away. That really makes it a lot more engaging, more immersive. And you can spend, you can see here the Oculus Rift, you can see the range on that. I mean, you can spend $300 on a really nice Oculus Rift set of goggles, but you can also do something called Google Cardboard homework assignment. It's only $15. Trust me, virtual reality is going to become part of your world more and more, especially as a marketer. So what I want you to do is I want you to go to Google Store and buy Google Cardboard. They're only $15. Get them and start experiencing some of the videos that are online. It's unbelievable how immersive, 360 degrees. I mean, you can put this little cardboard thing up and actually move around, look at your feet, look up and down, and you are in a virtual world. And animals, people, dinosaurs are actually interacting with you in this three-dimensional world, and you can see it for $15. So let me strongly recommend that you at least try it so that you can experience it, so that when it comes to reality and it comes to you and your position and your responsibility, that you got some experience in it. I probably spent 1,000 hours in Second Life programming it so I could understand it as a marketer. Plus, I loved it. I really loved it. Okay, so we're going to wrap this thing up, and I'm going to show you just an example of customer service, and we're almost there. This won't surprise you, but we haven't put all the pieces together. But let's suppose we had this scenario, a hotel chain, let's Marriott, Hilton, and I'm a frequent traveler, and I use them all the time. I have one of their little cards. I'm in a gold membership club or whatever the heck, and I want to book a room. So I can hit the app, and now I'm in the lobby of some hotel, could be the hotel that I'm looking for, the one that I stay at the most, and a virtual assistant pops up on my smartphone.
Greetings.
And it says hi, of course.
Let me welcome you to our hotel, Mr. Safko.
It knows who I am, because I'm logged into the app. It knows my preferences. It knows what I like, what I don't like. It has my credit card.
We are happy to have you stay with us.
And it's talking
Please
to me.
Follow me and I will show you to your room.
It's talking to me. I'm talking to it. I'm not typing anything. I don't need to do that. Voice recognition and voice synthesizing has been around forever. I was the first to commercialize both voice recognition and voice synthesizing. Voice synthesizing back in 78 and voice recognition in 85. So, and it's built in. That's what we do with Siri. That's what we do with the Amazon thing. So why are we using keyboards? We don't have to do that. Knows who I am and knows what my room preference is. Now, based on the property that I'm going to be staying at, all I have to do is say okay to Emily and follow her, and she can show me the room. And there isn't a fake room or something out of a brochure. This is the actual room that they're going to rent me. This is 1428, because they know what my preferences are based on my past experiences, the types of room that I've rented.
This room has two queen size beds and an ocean view as you requested.
I like ocean views. Of course I do. It knows that automatically.
This is to your liking, Mr. Safko. I will gladly book it for the dates you requested.
Yes, this is very nice. Please book it.
And I simply tell her?
Thank you. Your confirmation will be sent directly to your email.
No paper, no problem. Your confirmation is automatically sent to you. You get a barcode for checking in when you get there. your invoice, your receipt automatically gets sent to you. It's automatically charged to your credit card, so you don't even have to pull out your credit card. Everything is automated. Everything is anticipated. Look how simple it was to book the room. And I actually got to see the room before I booked it.
We look forward to serving you soon, and please let me know if
there's anything else I can do to help. Think about the capabilities of all of this. How can we use this as a marketer to extend the brand, to impress our customers, to make buying our product simpler, easier, more immersive, more engaging? And this example that I'm showing you has all of this built into it. You have AI that anticipates your room, your check-in time, whether you like late checkouts, early check-ins, the preferences on the room, automatically has your credit card, so it charges it, sends you the receipt. There's AR, augmented reality, that can show you the actual room, which we're looking at here, with a avatar, which is augmented to it. It could also have prices and what's in the mini bar and other information overlaid over the actual room. You got VR, where you can create a total, the lobby, let's say, for example, doesn't have to be real. It could be computer generated, because you don't care about the lobby, and that can be generic for everybody. So you have this mixture of AR, VR, and AI. And then of course you have IoT. How does that work? Well, your smartphone could have the key code, and all you do is tap the smartphone on the door lock and it unlocks it for the dates and times that you have rented that room. Then you come in and you wave your smartphone and the lights come on, and you sit down on the bed and you point your smartphone at the television and can control the media and the drapes all in your smartphone. So you can have all these things, and we're going to see that. We're going to see AI, AR, VR, and IoT built into every single thing that we do. Okay, so there's
Thank
a face.
Thank you for your time today. Let's open this up for Q&A.
Okay, so what do you think? You tell me what you think. You can turn your mics on. I told you, everybody has to ask at least one question.
Yeah, I have a question. What got the idea of virtual reality back when you were developing it?
Yeah, you know, the thing is I invented the first computer to save a human life. And what that means is that I was working with quadriplegics, people that could not move from their neck down. All they could move is their head. Mm-hmm. There were 52 million of them in the United States at that point. And I wanted to do something to help them. And I had already developed voice recognition, voice synthesizing, and home automation. I did it for fun because it was cool. Honest to goodness, that was the only reason. I thought it was cool to take an old Apple II and sit down and say, hi. And it would say, hi, who am I talking to? And I'd say, Lon. And so, oh, good morning, Lon. How are you? What would you like to talk about? I thought that was cool. So what I quickly realized when I was working with the disabled, they'd never used a computer before because they were physically disabled. So they couldn't actually hold a manual. They couldn't hold a cardboard paper manual. So I had to figure out some way to allow them to understand all of the capabilities that was in that software without ever using a computer. So it's like, how do I do that? Now, do you see this VR column? Mm-hmm. 1987, that was the first concept that I came up with. And then by 1994, once computers were able to do color, believe it or not, through the majority of its early life, no computers could do color. So for example, if you wanted to type a letter back in 1987, you would click on the typewriter that's sitting on the desk. Or if you wanted to place a phone call without arms, you could click on the phone. Or if you wanted to read a book or control the media, all of those items, what I thought was, if I create photographs, images, and the person can sit in front of it, I don't have to teach them. And that was the birth of VR for me. So if you've never seen it before, you can click on the appropriate button to do what you want it to do, because you were in this artificial environment with things that you were familiar with.
Awesome.
And then, of course, virtual reality went on from there. The gaming industry is really what drove virtual reality. That's where all the money was put into it. And let me tell you, gaming also really helped the internet, build the internet, because we didn't have servers and we didn't have broadband that could handle really good high quality graphics. And it really helped drive the development of graphic cards and faster processors because there was so much money in it. So it was really the gaming industry that pushed VR. And now we're using it for everything. Good question. Okay, so you don't have to buy lunch. You have another question? Okay, who has a question? Now's your chance. You don't get to talk to a crazy person like me that often.
I have a question.
Please.
So what are you involved in today or working on?
pretty much what you're seeing right now. I deliberately break my career generally about every 3 to 4 years. I do. I was working with the disabled, and then after that, I focused on marketing. I have 3 patents, U.S. patents on three-dimensional internet marketing. Then in 2007, I wrote the biggest and probably the most successful book on social media. It was 850 pages and sold $2 million in copies. It was called The Social Media Bible. So I'm constantly kind of evolving my career. Right now, I'm focusing a lot on this. This is cool stuff. This is cutting edge stuff. So I really enjoy it. And I work with Fortune 500 companies, getting them comfortable with this and showing them how to start thinking differently, mostly working with their marketing departments. Good question. Thank you.
Have you worked in the sports and entertainment industry? Like trying to develop a...
Do I work with sports and entertainment?
Yeah, as far as like trying to sell tickets.
Jerry Maguire. That was cool. I met him in Atlanta. He's a really cool guy. Doesn't look like Tom Cruise at all, by the way. But he was cool. Yeah. I have worked with sports, because especially in social media marketing, especially in the early days, because sports people really aren't very good at marketing themselves. Yeah, they kind of stand around and wait for them to get picked for the best teams, and then they hire people to negotiate their contracts. But they, as you've seen by a lot of the mistakes that sports players have made on social media over the last 10 years, that's what I was doing for a while, is helping them not make those mistakes. Don't post everything. Don't post stupid things. Don't react to people posting things about you. That was really kind of tough, because a lot of these people had a lot of testosterone. And when somebody said something, they just wanted to kind of lash out. So it was kind of difficult to teach. You know, you don't have to respond to everything. And how do you do it? And how do you do it appropriately? So I did sports and entertainment. Yeah, that was kind of the fun side, because I got a chance to meet a lot of famous people. Shauna, you have a question? Come on.
No, I don't really have a question, but I do have a statement. So when you went over the Chevrolet part, so I used to work with a company that got into it with Chevrolet, and basically they can slow down your car remotely. Like if somebody was to ever steal it, they can do a feature like that.
Yeah, actually that is built into the newer cars. Absolutely correct. If the car is involved in a police chase, then, of course you got to get 100 different kinds of authorization and everything. But yeah, that actually is being implemented, where if it's in a police chase, they can just shut off the car, just turn it off and bring the car to a full safe stop. Yeah. I mean, isn't that great too? That's a really good, example of, artificial intelligence and Internet of Things. You can save lives with that, no doubt. But then again, you wouldn't want, the reason that it's also difficult is that it'd be a cool prank to play on somebody, report their car stolen. So that's what they're trying to get around right now, is making sure that it's done properly. But yeah, that's a great observation. Yeah, thank you for that. Internet of Things and AI. See, it's everywhere. Any other questions? We have 2 minutes and 48 seconds. Come on, all that exciting stuff you've never even seen before. Are you just overwhelmed?
What do you think the next big invention or product's gonna be?
Yeah, that's an awesome, great question. Hayden, I'm gonna make sure that you get extra points for those questions here this morning. Good job. You know what? It's gonna be the integration. You're not seeing a lot of integration. And again, it gets back to when computers first came out, which you guys will weren't around to experience, but computers were dedicated. You had a dedicated word processor. You had a dedicated machine that only did basically one thing. But they were doing lots of different things. They just weren't doing it all at once. So what we saw, and I'm giving you historical references so that you can then apply those, because what happened in the past is going to happen now. So what we saw is computers now being able to do two things or three things, and then they became programmable with software so you can do anything you want. Kind of like a smartphone. The first smartphone made a phone call, and then it had a camera, and then it did this, and then now we see it does unbelievably amount of things. Well, you're going to see that a lot with this. You're going to see AI is probably entrenched more in the products that we use on a daily basis, more than any of these technologies. You're going to see lots and lots more of that. You're going to see chatbots and virtual assistants being used every single place you go. You're already seeing it, but you're going to see more of it. And AR, VR, IoT. IoT is probably the next one that you're going to start seeing a lot of, because again, you know, everything from a doorbell to a thermostat to a car, it's going to be more and more is our ability to use our smartphone to actually interconnect with our devices. But really where the push is going to be is we're going to see these things starting to all come together. Kind of like that example that I gave you at the end of the presentation for booking a room. Nobody's done that yet. Nobody's done it. There isn't any reason why Hilton or Marriott or somebody couldn't do it, because all the technology exists. And I've seen this time and time over the last 30 years. The technology exists, but nobody has taken it and fully integrated it. And as a marketing person, that is where the sweet spot is for you to understand that this is coming. Not only are each of these four technologies going to impact all of our lives, but the integration of these technologies. How can you use all four of these, or at least three, but all four, to really enhance your customer experience, your brand experience? So that's the goal. That's where we're going to be in 10 years. So it's up to you now to figure out how to get us there and to be the first, because that's where the money is, being the first. Great question. Any other questions?
How do you think AI will affect our military in the next like 10 to 15 years?
Say that again. AI will what?
Affect our military.
AI and military. Let me tell you, the military is driving AI probably more than any industry on the planet. And DARPA, you're probably all familiar with DARPA, they're the ones that are funded to do this. I mean, you got Boston Robotics creating some of the most amazing robots. And let me tell you, those robots are not being designed for us to play with them in the house or to do our vacuuming. They're all done, they're all being developed for military applications. Excellent observation. You're absolutely right. I mean, really, it's the military that's driving all of this. I mean, all of it, even the augmented reality. You see that they have glasses for actual warfare, where you put on the glasses and you can see the enemy and see the maps and see all this information, which is added to the actual vision that you can see through these glasses. VR, I mean, to some extent, VR, it was military. Virtual reality was actually invented by Thomas Furness III out of Wright-Patterson Air Force Base he finished up in the mid-80s. And what they did is they took an F-15 fighter jet, painted the cockpit black so that the pilot could not see out. And then using radar and LADAR and all of the other different technologies, they were able to recreate the ground on a screen using virtual reality, and that pilot could actually take off, run a mission, and then land safely by using virtual reality. So yeah, military is because they got the money, they got the funding. And then of course there's something that's called technology transfer. Once the military does it, because it was created using taxpayer dollars, the taxpayers actually own it. So that it's something called technology transfer, where that technology, once it's declassified, can then, the internet is the best example. I mean, that was military. It was top secret. Nobody knew anything about it. It was developed with taxpayer dollars. Once it was declassified, everybody uses the internet. So we're going to see a lot of that. Great observation. Thank you. Any other questions? Okay. Let's wrap this up, and I want to thank you for getting up this early in the morning, and I'd like you to speak to whoever schedule the class at 6 a.m. and tell them not to do that again. You guys have been a great class, and I appreciate the questions. So if we're good, I'm going to sign out.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, take care.